So you know I am a demanding person. I gather what I did not scatter. I harvest what I did not plant. Why you don't put my money in the bank so I have interest on my return? The day of the coming of Christ was not the preoccupation of the other Christians, but also the preoccupation of each one of us who come around this morning. Because that's what we pray. We pray that Jesus will come in glory. So when he comes, each one of us will receive the recompense of his life. In the first reading, I know that many women was like this. Because we are praising them. Open your ears. A woman can take you to heaven, and a woman can take you to hell. Beside a successful person, there is always somebody who really makes that person success. I always say, I am successful not because I am, because of the staff. If the staff is not successful, I will be not successful. Remember, dear people, that's what we read in the first reading today. That woman, who really was very careful about the money of her husband, and how industrious she was, that she continued to supply with the income of her husband with the work of her hands. And how she used to take these job that she do and lay them there at the gates of the city for people to buy them. And from the money she made, she will care for the poor and the needs of her family. And that is why it is very important to know that that reading was given to us. Yes, it is written in praise of women, but it is for each one of us. And that reading is going to take us now to the gospel. And in the gospel we find Jesus speak about interpreter again. There was a man who was going on a journey, and he entrusted his possessions in the care of those around him. To some, to one, he gives 5 talents. To another, he gave 2 talents. To another, 1, according to their ability. And those abilities are the gifts that God gives us, those talents that God gave to each one of us. And some people say, well, I have no talents. You don't? So you don't exist. Because God does not create junk. Each one of us have been given gifts. You have the gift of hearing. To hear somebody with a heavy heart. You have a heart of generosity. You open your heart to share what you have. There is a heart that really is instructor, and you instruct others, so others too will have a better life. God gave each one of us many talents. And God is asking us to use them. Because those talents were given to you, but not for you, that you will give to others. As you have received them freely, freely you need to give them. And our accountability is not how much talents you have, but what you did with what you have. God is not going to be unjust and punish us for things that we didn't know, or didn't have, or didn't do, but for things that he gave us, and we thought, this is mine. Because today we are living in a world that the only person that is important is me. Me, second me, third me. We lost the idea. Through computers, through anything that we have today, that we are not individuals, but we are called to be a community. And that's why today Jesus said to the one who had 1 talent, you know I am a demented person. And you know that the one who was talking is demented. I do demand things from people. because I see the abilities that they have. And some of them, they waste their time. They waste their abilities, and they can use them for the good of the community. And that's why it is very important that we listen to Jesus today when he said to the one who had 5 and 2, good and faithful, come now and inherit the kingdom as I give you now what you have shown me in small matters, responsibilities. But I'd like to go to St. Paul today and see what St. Paul has to offer. Remember, the people of Thessalonica, due to the fact that St. Paul really hammered them with the coming of Christ, which is the responsibility of every Christian, they thought that Christ was going to come today. Some of them kept working, some of them were waiting and say, why bother, do anything, let's come and wait for the Lord. And St. Paul said to them, I don't need to write to you about season or time, but you know that the Lord is coming, and he comes like a thief in the night. He's not going to give you any, what is called, preparation. Oh, I am coming on such a day, at such time. It's not for us to know. For us to know is to keep vigil, to keep always ready, to be ready to meet the Lord when he comes. And that is very important, dear people. That's why St. Paul reminds us that the day will come like a thief in the night. If you know the time the thief is going to break into your house, you will have many police around and you will be awake and you will not let your house be broken into. And that is the vigil that St. Paul is asking us to do. But there is one sentence that St. Paul said today, and I hope it's going to be hammered into your brains. We are children of light. We are children of the day. If we are children of light, we are not children of darkness. So don't give me that excuse that you go to church and sing the Alleluias and try to pretend that you are, and then when you leave those doors, you join the darkness of that world. You have to make a difference. You have to be different. Not because everyone is going to Atlantic City, you have to join them. If I have no money, because if I have, I will go. My dear people, you cannot follow darkness because we have a light in our hands. And that light has to shine. Remember last Sunday? And how is it going to shine? Because I am going to pour oil in those banners to light more, so that I will not be dim, or my light will be out. And what kind of oil is it? It's the good work that we produce. The charity that we use for another. That's why St. Paul said, keep vigil. Be sober. Alert. Don't go to sleep. Because this is the job that we have. As many tell me, work now. Because the retirement is forever and ever, for eternity, and then you have time to sleep. Now is the time to work. That's why we call the church militant. This is a church that is working, vigilant. What good is that soldier that's supposed to be watching so that the enemy does not approach, and then he puts his arms down and let the enemy come in and take his country? What good is this? What good it is to that doctor who take a note that he will save life, that he would never want to see patient, that he does not want to give any medication, does not want to share with what we know, with his people who comes to him? What good it is that lawyer that you select to defend you in court if his code of the law is not in his hands constantly? Because when he goes in front of the judge, it will be submitted, it will be benched and thrown out of court. My dear people, this is what God is asking us. What is it that we are Christians if we don't help one another to bring each other to salvation? You have that responsibility. You have that talent. Many people say, well, I taught my husband to come and I taught, you know, know what? Don't blame your husband. You blame you. Because if your husband is not seeing an example of a Christian, he's not going to follow. You say, what do you mean by that? What do you mean by that is? Do you have prayers at home? Do you say prayers together? Do you invoke God in all the troubles of life? Do you bring God in your problems that you have and ask him for strength and direction? Do you really make sacrifices and offer your life as a prayer to God for these people? Do you pray for them that they will have a change of heart? But your people, don't tell me they are bad. Because I tell you what John Paul told us when we had with him in an audience in 1983. In order that the world goes bad, does not mean that the good become bad, just for the good to remain silent. You get that? Just for the good to remain silent. Many times we see evil and we say, well, it's not my business. Yes, this is your business. Do you want your son to go to hell? Do you want your daughter to go to hell? If you say yes, you don't belong here. Because you are a mother, and you are a father, and you want your loved ones to go with you, where God is calling us to be one day. Today we call about the sin of omission. That man, he went and hid it, because he was afraid that he will lose it. How many times we hide our talents? And we excuse behind, you know, it's not my business, I am not involved in this, the nuns and the priests, apostles and this. By virtue of baptism, you light that candle, and you become the light in the world of darkness. Is your light shining? When people look at you, they can say, there is a difference in your life, or you have made a difference in their lives. When they look at you, they see that you are a different person from the common world, from the world of greed, from the world of sex, from the world of everything that they possess today. Can they see you different from that light? Or they see you that you are one of the cart that's got passed by? My dear people, that's why St. Paul said to us that we have to be accountable. And each one of us has to be accountable for what God has given him. At the end of the journey, you and I, we are going to be in front of him. And there I'm going to account for all those things that I failed to do. Also for those things by which I went against the commandments of God. I speak for myself. I have much to answer to the Lord for what I did, for those things of omission. For many times I see you doing things that are not proper, and I remain silent, because I don't want trouble for myself. For many times I see things in the parish going on, and I don't put my foot on it. For many times I say things to you, and they are not proper the way I said them. My dear people, all of us have those things. And all of us are in the same boat. Because it's my daughter, I don't want, you know, that I break the relation with her, because she will leave home. You know what my father used to say? Let her go. Nobody is going to feed her for nothing. My dear people, we cannot allow people to dance in front of us and make us afraid. Do not be afraid, I am with you. If he is with us, who can be against us? If he promised that he is going to be with us, who can turn against us? Because there is the sword, because there is famine, because there is persecution, nothing can separate us from the love of Christ. But we have to have that relationship with him. My dear parents, today you are here. One of the sin of omission is sometimes we take it for granted that sister is going to teach them the arguments of faith. That the sister, the teachers, or the parents of the school that you send them, a parochial school, are going to take them and educate them in the faith. By virtue of your baptismal vows, when you present your child for baptism, you took for responsibility to be the first parents of these children. And so don't tell me about them. And don't tell me about them. You tell me about me. Each one of us here, to be our parents, we are building tomorrow. And tomorrow will come before you know it. And that's why I am pleading with you that you will be a good example. That Sunday Mass is not here for God. It's a responsibility that we have to thank God for all the blessings He has bestowed on us. That you say prayers together, eat together. It's very important. Eat together. So that your children will have a notion of what we do here when we come around this altar. I speak to you about it when I have the meeting Monday with you. And yet, people, we have to begin at home. There is the domestic church. There everything is taught. There is the school of love. There I learn how to be. There I learn how to love. There I learn how to respect. And if we do so, I promise you that these children will follow in your footsteps. Because these young ones, they look up to you. You are their heroes. You are the people in their lives that they really trust. They love you much because they see so much love coming from you to them. And so what I ask of you today is, as you commit yourself again to the renewal of your baptismal promises, that you are going to do again on their behalf, although they are going to hear them and they don't understand them, reinforce within them the love for the Lord Jesus. Teach them their prayers at home. Because that is what really the responsibility of a parent is. If you want your child to have to do the right thing tomorrow, you have to lead them on the right path. Sometimes you lead them on the right path and they turn and thank God that they come to their senses and they come back to what we give them. But if we don't give it to them, what kind of direction they are going to come back if they are lost in some direction? I always believe, and I am sure of this 100%, that if you teach good, even if your child is astray at the age of 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 20, they will come back. And they will come back to what you taught them. Do you ever notice that when your son, your daughter have a baby, they raise that baby in the way you raise them? Sight. We are like monkeys. Monkey do, monkey say, monkey hear. Because we are animals with reason. And we need people to lead us. If you have a dog and say sit, and does not obey you the first time, but then when you show him a treat and tell him sit, oh, he wants this. So for this, you do what you want. And before you know it, you train the dog to be there. I always say, my dog obeys me more than you will put together. My dear people, as we continue the celebration of the Mass today, let us ask God to give us the courage to understand the noble responsibility we have. That we need to be a community. That we need to learn from the experience of home how to love. How nice it is that you train your children, even if they are young, to go and pick up the mail and give it to your neighbor who is elderly. To tell your son to take a shovel and take the snow when the snow. To tell your son to go and bring the list from Mrs. Smith so that you can help her bring some things from the store. What a nice thing it is that your husband or yourself will take Mrs. Smith at the doctor's because she needs to go to appointment. They need to see this. Your children need this to see. Visual aid. We live by sight in this life. But also we need faith. And when you do these things, before you know it, your son will say, thank you. Open the door for an elderly person or for a woman or for somebody who is coming. You see that he excused himself from the table. That the parents and the teachers in school, they praise him how educated he is. Education does not begin when he is six. It begins when he is 2 days old. And yet, people, I plead with you. You are the builders of tomorrow's society. You are the one who are going to give us a future church. And if you see that we are going to stay here, priests and religious, you are a dreamer. I look at our community of nuns. They're all coming up there. I'm not going to say their ages because they're all 39 plus. But there's no vocations. We priests are retiring more priests than ordaining. In 1 year, we released, retired about 6 or 7 priests, and only 3 ordained. And you want parishes to be open? And you want parishes to be like this, empty pews? I don't think so. I think more will be closed. And more will come smaller and bigger, because there is no one to serve. And you people in this last century, the church gave you power. Power to the laity, empower the laity. How can we empower if you don't care? How can we empower you if you don't come and help us sharing, shoulder to shoulder, the responsibility of the parish? How many of these elderly people today, they are retired and waste their time in front of the television? Television for me is for 2 minutes. Once I sit in that chair, you will hear. Number one, there is nothing to see on television. It's nonsense. But your thing is this, that why waste your time playing cards, sitting, doing nothing, going to bars, going to your clubs, and waste your time, foolish talking, and this, when you can call somebody who is sick? Well, that will give you the numbers of these people after we have their permission. And how are you? We are really missing you in church. How things are? What's going on? Can I do something for you? Sending a card on their birthdays that we care. Taking a pledge at Christmas or Easter, although the youth are going to do it this year. Thank God. But we need to do things for people. That is a community. Not because we have this much in the bank, if we don't. But a community is alive from what they care for each other. Oh, how much I love when I hear, do you know, I live on such and such a street. And do you know, when they don't see me for 2 days, they give me a call. Because they care if I am all right or not. Father, thank God for these people, because you know, I was sick for 3 months. And you know, the next door neighbor, they cooked dinner for us. They did this. The husband took my wife to the hospital. And also the doctor, because our car, we have only one car. That is the joy that I receive. And I say, oh, my dear Lord, here we go. We are coming. We become the early church. They share everything in common. And they were one in mind and heart in the breaking of the bread and the teaching of the apostles. And they were happy. They were selling their homes. And they said to Peter, here is the money. Do whatever you want with it. Come on, let me challenge you to see you do that. You see, that is the goal of a church. A church is not lights and painting and this and that. That's all right, because we need visual aid and we need beauty to really ascend to the beauty of God. But that is here, remain here. What takes place there is what church is all about. Dear people, I ask you, during communion, when Jesus comes to you, said, Jesus, show me my talents and ask me to offer it. Because your gift to God will be, not because you come to Mass, you come to Mass for yourself because you need God. But now when you leave that church, what are you going to give to God in return? And that is your work. So when you come next week, when that patent is offered, when I take that patent, I take all your goods that you have given and say, Lord, this is what we offer you, the good of the people of St. Rita. And you will be so proud of yourself because you have been part of the mystery of the divine plan. Jesus did not say, go and sit in pews. Go now and teach all people. As what I have done to you, do it to another. If we do so, then we don't need anymore, you know, people to tell us what to do. Because all of you know that you are called to serve, to love God. Because at the end of this journey, you have to be accountable for what we have done with the gifts and talents He has given us. God bless you.